Hello, and welcome to Shine Chats. I'm Rachel Nelson, president of Exan Group at Henry Schein One, and I'm here today with Dr. Mark Wolff, dean of the University of Pennsylvania School of Dental Medicine. Welcome.
Hi.
So I think we want to just kind of start off the conversation really around interoperability. What does it mean? How would you define it, and why is it important?
We live in a complex world. Patients see dozens of practitioners, have lots of dentistry done, lots of medicine done, and the ability for us to actually get a full picture of the patient prior to performing dental care just becomes incredibly important. The question of interoperability has plagued medicine and dentistry for decades, and there are some solutions to it today, but all of them have pluses and minuses.
I think it's interesting, especially when we look back on your journey at your school, how this conversation has transitioned. And I think it starts often with like interprofessional care. What is the relationship between dental and medical, or even, you know, social care? And then what does that mean in terms of technology? And maybe just bring us up to speed a little bit with what your school is currently doing to promote interoperability.
So in our current environment, we're working inside several federally qualified health centers, one of which will be connected through Epic to our Penn Medicine hospital system. And we are setting up to have bi-directional interoperability with that system. Before that, we had unidirectional, where we could pull information. We see about a third of our patients at our dental care center are patients of Penn Medicine. And we have the ability at the click of a button to pull summary sheets that pull in the latest lab values, the latest physician summaries, the results of an electrocardiogram, the results of radiographs. We could get the radiographs if we wanted them, but we don't want to interpret a spinal series or a fractured arm. We would much rather read the results from the radiologist. We would rather get a summary note, for instance, from the healthcare providers about the healthcare. So we pull that information in and we use that commonly within our school. Within the federally qualified health center, we're going to be sending back data on what type of treatment was done. Did we do fluoride treatments, and did we do preventive care? Did we do tobacco cessation? Are we requesting consults? And it will be done in a bi-directional fashion.
What has been your experience? Because I find it really fascinating. It's no surprise to the oral healthcare side of the equation that what we do matters and is relevant to overall health. How has that narrative changed? Because I think even you just mentioned you started pulling in data, and now all of a sudden it turns out, oh, medicine is actually interested in what we can offer.
So federally qualified health centers are this best example of whole health. They measure health outcomes, and many of the measures of health outcomes actually includes oral health outcomes. For instance, examinations and fluoride treatments on children are measures of health outcomes. Our medical center, the family medicine individuals, are interested in knowing what we have done to promote general health as well as oral health. We take blood pressures on our patients. We do pulse oximetry. We do monitoring. All of that data can be shared with medicine as if the person had been in a general healthcare environment.
If all of these things are great, and if we can do them, what are the barriers to more institutions not doing it? What are the barriers you see?
I think that we've braved much of the new world, and the interface that we use is a fairly common interface that works with Epic specifically. And I think that you'll see more institutions choose to use this methodology. You know, having the opportunity to look directly at Epic and pull the information ourselves can be daunting. To sort out, you know, the important information, they're allergic to such and such, they are taking the following medications, which affect care, or they have the following autoimmune diseases. Those are things that affect our care, and not so much the urinary output while the patient was in the hospital. And we like to sort through that and get to the chase a little bit quicker.
What advice would you give to a school that was thinking about moving towards interoperability?
Well, I like the solution we have right now. Look at it at other institutions, you know, come visit us at Penn Dental Medicine, and we're always happy to show off what we're doing well. We never show off what we're not doing. We'll always tell the truth.
Well, so it's fine.
We'll always tell the truth. That's not a question. But for me, it's think pre-plan. Ask the question, what do you really want out of the data? What data is going to help you in your oral health care? I would love to have a full data set of all the diagnosis codes, the ICD-10s, that are attached to this particular patient, because I can start doing correlations between ICD-10 and pocket depth or frequency or things like that. So there's data that we really want to pull into the system. There's a lot of data that is irrelevant to us. The past 50 blood tests are not as important to us as the most recent or the history of. We need to understand what we want to look at as data. So starting out, it's ask what data is going to change your care? What data is going to be needed for research? What data do you really want? And then start looking at, can the system be filtered or managed such that it delivers that?
No, I think one of the interesting pieces also is just looking at, are you using what you have today? And I often encourage, you know, schools to look at electronic prescriptions, the amount of data that you can pull in just by using electronic prescriptions. You have access to alerts and medications. And that's, you know, just by using electronic prescriptions or, you know, requiring diagnosis. So actually starting to format how you're treating patients in a similar way by actually requiring diagnostic codes when you're doing your treatment entry, which to some schools is completely natural, but others is actually a new best practice.
Yeah. So at a prior institution, we use the full Snowden. I'm embarrassed to say at my current institution where we're not as engaged in utilizing the diagnostic codes as I really would like. It's very important from a research standpoint, from patient correlation and disease standpoint. We do use, in both institutions, we've been using electronic prescription. And it's incredible when you find out from the database how many medications the patient is taking that are not already in their medical history. Oops, yeah, I do take that too. Oops, I do take that also. It's a little, I don't want to call it embarrassing, but it's interesting to see how many medications people forget that they're taking.
Yeah, that's, I think often I always, you know, recommend it's starting small, but I like that idea of starting with the place of what is relevant, what is important for us to achieve this. And it's most likely for most organizations, a phased approach. And you've been a great success in kind of spearheading some of those initiatives. Well, I think that is it for today. So Dr. Wolff, I thank you so much for your time. As always, it is a pleasure learning about what you are doing at the University of Pennsylvania. And I look forward to talking more.
I invite anybody who's interested to reach out to University of Pennsylvania or come through Henry Schein to ask for connection to us. We're always pleased to assist. Rachel, thank you for the opportunity.
Take care. Have a great day.